name is Dennis Carter. I first looked up there and I saw oops on there, and I thought, ooh. Yeah. That's normally me, oops. But no, I may go by oops, but my name is Dennis Carter. I'm pastor here at First United Methodist Church here in Ellsworth and also in Kannapolis, and it's just a joy and a blessing to have you here. I pray that each and everyone feels God's presence, knowing that we've been made in the image of God, and God desires a relationship with us that is real, that is personal. And I pray you feel God's love today. And what a blessing to have you here. So at this time, we'll have announcements. Raise your hand and they'll bring a mic to you. All right. Okay.
I'd just like to thank everybody for the cards and letters since my brother passed away. It's greatly appreciated.
Okay, I got another clipboard. I didn't want to overwhelm you last week. So, first of all, so thank you for everybody that signed up. We got pretty much everything that was on the list, so thank you so much. And those of you that gave money, thank you for that as well. The sign-up sheet today is for the Teacher's Lounge snacks. And you can, it can be cookies, it can be chips, it can be ham and cheese, it can be fruit, whatever you want that you can provide would be great. And if you could have that at the school by 9 o'clock each morning, okay? Then the last thing is, I'm having surgery on Tuesday, back surgery, so if you would please keep me in your prayers, the doctors in your prayers, my husband in your prayers. So just really need some prayers for us, so I would appreciate that if you could. So I will start this around.
We had our baby, and we named her baby Indy. Indy Joy.
Indy Joy was born Thursday at 2:10, 6 pounds, 8 ounces, 19 inches. And everybody's doing pretty well. She's learning what the word sleep means at night, so we're going to get there.
All right. What a blessing. Thank you for sharing.
Hi. I'd like prayers for Stoney. And most of you probably have heard he had a fall last Monday morning. And so it's been an interesting week for sure. He's got been in extreme pain, and he hit his arm, the right arm. And it's been quite a painful experience for him. And he was planning to be here this morning. He was dressed, ready to come, and now all of a sudden he was not feeling well. And he said his stomach's queasy, but he's been on pain pills, so that might be part of that. And so he's got a ways, long ways to go on this, so I just ask for prayer for that. Thank you.
So keep Stoney in your thoughts and prayers for recovery.
I have a couple. First of all, your secretary didn't proofread things very well, so on the duties list, responsibilities, she failed to, on June 11th, take out the communion. So those of you that are looking at it and saying, oh, we're having communion two Sundays, that's not correct, because your secretary didn't do her job this week. The second thing is, I just want to say that our church is very blessed to have people that will step up and even out of their comfort zone to cover for some of us that are gone. You know, like last week we had recorded music, and Amy played the guitar for us, and while the rest of us took off for the weekend. So I think we're just very blessed as a church family to have people that will step up and help continue on with God's work. The second thing is, I also have a sign-up sheet. This is for our summer lunches, and so I have it, location is Wilson, Ellsworth, and then Kannapolis, And then Geneseo, we're still trying to figure that one out. So if there's any time that you can help in any of those locations, please put your name down, and we'll just kind of go from there and see where we end up at. Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any others?
Yeah, okay. Klein is.
I also want to thank you all for, as we work through the disaffiliation, how we carried boxes down, and those sorted, and what a blessing it was picked up, and what a blessing. This church is such a blessing. Go ahead.
So a couple real quick. One is, you'll see in the bulletin, the announcement, the next Sunday we'll have our second snack and chat before worship. Because it's only the second one, you may not be familiar with it. All we're trying to do is give an opportunity that if you wish to come to worship service a little early, we'll have some coffee, some other drinks, some donuts and so forth available. So we have an opportunity to visit before we go into worship. So if you want to come a little early next week and participate in that, you certainly are welcome to. The second part I just wanted to also lift up, Tuesday evening will be the leadership team meeting. Everybody is invited to that. I want you to be aware of it anyway. There's a lot of activity that's going on this week, this month, as we formalize some of the disaffiliation and the reaffiliation. So if you're interested in it, you are certainly welcome to participate in that. So thank you.
Are there any? Oh, here we go. Mary has one over here.
I just have a praise. Thank you guys for all your prayers. I have my prayer answer with me. This is my mom, and she's doing very well, and she had her MRI this last week, and her stroke's resolving really nicely, and she's doing really well.
Some of you know my sister is here already living with us, came in last weekend, but the blessing is they listed her house Friday and it sold yesterday, so now we just start the hunting process. So, but
God,
thank you
good,
for the,
right?
You betcha, you betcha.
Say anything, but I just couldn't not. Roberta and I had the blessing of going through the whole room full of boxes, you know, that to sort out what we needed to send to archive and what not. Anyway, and got it condensed down to seven, something like seven boxes. But the thing that was just so fun was going through and seeing how God has worked in our community since the days of the cowboys. And how the first congregation met in a stone building where the grade school is, in the corner of the grade school. And then they met in tops of second stories of a couple of different places downtown. But, you know, we sometimes get discouraged and think, where is God working? God is working. He has been working. He's not going to stop working. And it is our job to continue to be a conduit through which His Spirit flows through us. So, not that we stand proud of anything that any of us have ever done. It is God who has worked in our midst.
Thank you, Alice. And at the last Sunday of the month, we'll have, instead of just Cookie Sunday, we'll have a covered dish dinner. And we're going to take the time after we eat, of course, but share different things of this church and how you've seen God work and just share memories. And I'm looking forward to that. So that'll be good, too. But thank you, Alice, so much. Are there any others?
Yes.
Yes.
On that, yeah, I think I'm correct in saying that we're not going to have...
I think they're going to give you a mic.
Oh, I don't want a mic.
You may not want the mic, but it's yours.
It's mine. I want to make sure that on Cookie Sunday, I think we're not having the cookies. I think we're going to have desserts just brought in like a regular potluck, I think.
Yeah.
Am I correct? Okay, just so everybody knows.
Okay. Well, thank you. Okay. If that's your alarm, wake up. No. All right. Do we have anything else? Betty, did you want to say anything? You didn't? Okay, well, yes, we'll be praying for safe travel. We'll be going to Missouri. We'll be back Friday night, and looking forward to that. But we also had the opportunity to go to Mead and be with a 3.5, or almost 3.5, a 9-month-old. And the last 2 weeks, the 9-month-old has learned to growl. Wow, it's just wonderful. And anyway, like Jason was talking about, having a new baby, we know we're going to have another new baby coming. I can see why God has let younger people have children. That's all I need to say.
That's kids me.
Because I'm going to sleep really good, Jason, for probably a month. But anyway, what a blessing. So at this time, let us greet one another, if you would. So we'll go greet one another.
That's up on the screen and in your bulletin. I will be a poor substitute for David Stonebreaker this morning. So, O Lord, our Sovereign, you have set your glory above the heavens, out of the mouths of babes and infants.
Lift up Ed and minister to him as he grieves the loss of his brother. And so thankful for all the calls and the cards and the letters, and what a blessing that is. Dear Lord, we lift up VBS that will start tomorrow. Dear Lord, for the opportunity, dear Lord, for the children to hear about God's love, about God's forgiveness, about a Lord and a Savior that desires to be their best friend. And we just thank you and praise you for this. Minister to each and every heart. Dear Lord, I also want to lift up prayer concerns or joys that may not have been lifted up. But dear Lord, we lift them up to you now. Also, it's such a blessing to see Mary's mother here and continuing to minister to her. Dear Lord, for those that will be traveling, and there will be a lot of traveling coming on the next 3 months, we pray for traveling mercies and safety. I thank you again for first loving us. I thank you again for forgiving us. Just minister to each and every heart. Draw us all closer to your love and grace. And dear Lord, no matter what we're going through, you are there. Also, gracious God, this is the time as we say the Lord's Prayer together. Dear Lord, I just thank you again. These words, and by your grace and by your Spirit, that we live out each word as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. Now at this time, if you're comfortable standing, would you please stand as we sing the hymn Blessed Assurance, found in the hymnal number 369 or up on the screen. Blessed Assurance. Thank you. sure, Warmy? All right. Okay. How y'all doing? Good. That's great. And this is a Warmy. Did you all know that? A Warmy. Yeah, you put it. That's what you call him because you put him in the microwave and heat him up, and it's safe. He's microwave safe, right? And he smells good now. Okay. Okay, a lot of things coming out of the microwave smell good. All right. But he smells good, but he keeps you warm, right? All right. What are some of the things that make you feel warm? Who? Patchy? It's her dog. Your dog is warm all the time. It makes you feel good. And blankets make you feel good and warm. How about you? Your heated mattress? Okay. Boy, you guys, I better be more lively today. You guys are going to be sleeping on me, I think. What makes you feel good? No, I didn't get it right. Are you an interpreter? Okay, all right. Okay. I'll try it one more time. Pop, pop. No, I'm not getting it right. I definitely do not have that gift of interpretation. But anyway, but I know it's important. And when I ask what makes you feel good, how would you like it that someone cares so much that they would invite you to dinner? They invite you to be their best friend? Would that make you feel good? You know who did that? God, yeah. Jesus invited. And he would have dinner with all kinds of people. He did not leave anyone out. He wanted to have dinner with them because he cared for them. He loved them. And he wanted them to know about his love and his forgiveness. You're right. God has invited us, right? God cares for us. And that does make us feel good. Boy, you guys did an awesome job. And I'm going to be talking about communion and how Jesus wants us to all come to that table. It's his table. You had communion at your grandma and grandpa's church? I bet it was good, wasn't it? Do you like communion? What do you like about communion? The bread and the juice. All right. All right. Okay, what's that? All right. She says, the bread represents Jesus' body, and the juice represents his blood to cover our sins. Very good. There's your warming. Yes. You got one more thing? Okay. Oh, so when you're cold at night, and then your dog keeps you warm? That is a good dog. I think I'll go ahead and have prayer. You guys are doing great. You guys ready for prayer? Okay. And then after it's over, then they'll bring you snacks, okay? All right. All right. That kind of makes you feel good too, right? All right. Okay, here we go. Gracious God, we thank you for loving us and desiring to be with us. You want to be with us. You want to be our friend. And dear Lord, you love us more than anyone, and we thank you for that. So dear Lord, bless these children. Allow them to feel your love, your presence. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Well, thank you all for coming. You can go back to your folks.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for love I will tell, speak so, never. offering after the doxology. They'll be meeting in the basement. But do we have a nursery attendant for those that are younger than that? And they can go anytime.
Okay. All right. Okay.
So at this time, we have a hymn, Make Me a Servant. We will sing that twice. And that's found in the Things We Sing, the Thinner Book, 2176, or up on the screen. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we come before you today as we join you in ministry. We ask that you bless this offering we're about to receive, that it further your kingdom, that people would hear the good news of Jesus Christ, of his life, death, and resurrection, that we serve a Lord that has defeated both sin and death, that is seated at the right hand of the Father Almighty. We just thank you and praise you. But not only bless this offering we're about to receive, but dear Lord, I pray that each and every one that can hear my voice, that you would bless them. Bless those who are able to give financially of time, service, prayer, and their presence. We just thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. time, Clyde's going to lead us in scripture reading.
Our scripture reading for this morning come from two different books of the Bible. We'll start with John and move then to Matthew. So the first one, John 13, 1 through 11. Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." The second reading is from Matthew, Matthew chapter 26, verses 26 through 30. It says, "While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to the disciples, and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.' When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Klein. At this time, would you please bow with me for a word of prayer? Gracious God, Heavenly Father, I come before you today, humbly before you, and ask that you would give me the words, that they'd be your words. As we look at how Jesus invited, how he wanted all at his table. Dear Lord, we just thank you and praise you for your love, your grace, and your mercy. And what a blessing it is to be in your presence. In Jesus' precious name, amen. When we look at the life of Jesus to see who he really was, one will notice something very curious. Jesus spent a lot of time around the dinner table. I love that. I can do that. I can do the dinner table well. Many of his most frequent quoted messages and standout stories happen while sharing a meal with others. And those others around the table were remarkably diverse cast. Jesus shared meals with the outcast. He spent time with the self-righteous elite. He cared for people who had broken every rule and were even seen as unclean. Jesus dined at the tables of the wealthy men whose riches were won with lies and corruption. Some of those men gave up comfortable lifestyles to follow him. He crossed racial boundaries to the shock of many around him. He invited everyone to the table. When asked why he did so, Jesus replied, "The reason I was born and came into this world is to testify the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." John 18:37. It was radical at the time. No one was that inclusive. The religious do-gooders began to worship behind, whisper behind his back. They called him a friend of sinners. It was supposed to be an insult, but Jesus wore it proudly. He was a friend to everyone, And what do friends do? They eat together and share in each other's lives. And in Jesus' time, when they share a meal, when they had a meal together, it might last 4 hours. That's a little bit longer than what we do today. Sometimes our meal may only be 10, 15 minutes. At least for me, anyway. You can ask Betty. This is not a sermon illustration. I eat much like my dog, Barnabas. Barnabas, especially when he goes out to Starbucks around other dogs, he'll take his food, he'll eat it so fast, I don't even know if it touches his teeth. It's kind of like a shop vac. And I'm much the same way, but I'm trying to do better. Probably the very first time Betty and I had a meal together, she thought no one could eat so slow. But I've broken that habit. I was just glad to hear her and what she had to say. Oh, I'm still glad to hear you, Betty. Strangers eat together and become friends. Isn't that right? When you break bread together, you do become friends. You get to know someone better, and it's such a wonderful thing. And what a simple concept, yet we're pretty sure it wouldn't turn out that way in our modern upside-down world that we live. And it also was the same way with Jesus, even 2,000 years ago. Actually, when Betty and I was in Andover United Methodist Church, they had a food bank on Wednesdays, and after it was over, they had a meal for everyone. Everyone was invited. And Betty and I took it upon ourselves that we would sit at different tables. Not with each other, but we'd sit at different tables so we'd get to know others better. Betty, what did the one lady ask you?
She said, "When you guys go out to eat, will you sit at the same table?"
And if they didn't hear that on the mic, they said, "If you guys go out to eat, do you sit at the same table?" Well, I do if I want someone to pay for it, right? No. But there are division and broken relationships everywhere. I mean, people can be so judgmental. There can be such hypocrisy, and it's on the rise. It hasn't got any better. We see people who claim to be followers of Jesus taking his open invitation and turning it into an exclusive club. And that wasn't Jesus. Jesus wanted all to come. He wanted to be a friend to all. Not all received it. Not all accepted it. But that's who Jesus is. He is not exclusive. He was radically inclusive. What would our world look like if that were our norm? If we would be open to others? If strangers became friends over dinner table as they did around Jesus. So when we look at John 13:1-11, the first verse was, it was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that his time had come to leave the world and go back to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, his disciples, he loved them to the end. And then when I read this from John, it was before the Passover festival. You're going to say, oh, okay, now I can see where the Bible isn't always
even follows each other, because Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they talk about the Last Supper. The Passover meal was Thursday. But yet, on Friday morning, that they took him after he was arrested, and they took him to Pontius Pilate. And they didn't want to go to the Praetorium because they didn't want to be unclean, so they couldn't eat the Passover meal. So you say, well, what's up with that? Well, let me explain it to you. In the north area of Israel, around the Galilean area, their days, the way they told the days, were from sunrise to sunrise. But in the Judean area, where the Sadducees were, the ones that controlled the temple, their days were from evening to evening. So you can see there was, and it made it really good at the Passover time, because there was actually, when Jesus was crucified, they would have been killing the Passover lambs. Those that had the southern time are those in the Judean area. You see, Josephus, the historian, you could have 10 people per one lamb during the Passover. And he said this was in the 60s, 60 AD, not 1960, but 60 AD, because after 70, the temple was destroyed and by the Romans, and they didn't have that anymore. But back in 60 AD, he said there was 250,000 sheep were slaughtered. So there would have been up to 2.5 million, and it gave them two separate days to do this, if they were to have been on the northern time or the southern time. So I wanted to explain that to you a little bit. And when I think of that, those two different methods of reckoning days, we go now to verse 1 again. He loved them to the end, his disciples. He had been with them for 3 years. He taught them. He led them. He prayed for them. He wanted to be with them. Even though, can you believe, people that have been around Jesus for 3 years would argue? They were arguing who was going to get the best seat. Actually, one that betrayed him was sitting next to him. We see that in the second verse with Judas. In intending to betray Jesus, Judas had opened the door for the devil to put a specific idea into his heart. He was going to betray him. He was going to hand him over. And in verses 3 through 5, Jesus took the humble role of a servant, washing the dirty feet of those who should have been washing his. Why? Why would Jesus do that? Because he came to serve. In Mark 10:45. To this servanthood mindset, the Lord calls each of us to serve one another. And in verse 10 of chapter 13 of John, in other words, if you're already saved, you don't need to be saved again. Can't you just hear Peter saying, they say his, you would know Peter because his mouth was shaped of a foot, because he's always putting his foot in it. Or he wore peppermint socks or something like that. I can relate. My mouth is probably shaped much like a foot. When Jesus said that he must wash him, his feet, he said, no. You know, you can't do that, Jesus. You can't come down as a servant like that. He says, yes, I have to, or you're not with me. And then he said, okay, well then do my hands and do my head. He said, no. In other words, if you're already saved, you don't need to be saved again. You just need to address the dirty areas in her life so that you can stay clean. To maintain fellowship with the Lord, you must regularly come to Him in confession and repentance. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and righteous to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. When I look at from the writings of Max Lucado, he talks about when we read Matthew, the account of the Last Supper, one incredible truth surfaces. Jesus is the person behind it all. It is Jesus who selected the place, designated the time, and set the meal in order. The chosen time is near. I will have the Passover with my followers and you're at your house. Matthew 26:18. And the supper, Jesus was not a guest, but he was a host. Jesus gave it to the disciples. The subject of the verbs is the message of the event. Jesus took, he blessed, he broke, and he gave. And at the supper, Jesus is not the served one, but he is actually the servant. It was Jesus who, during the supper, put on the garb of the servant and washed the disciples' feet in John 13:5. Jesus was the most active one at the table. Jesus is not portrayed as the one who reclined and received, but the one who served and who gave. He still does. The Lord's Supper is a gift to you. The Lord's Supper is a sacrament, not a sacrifice. Sacraments are sacred moments that Jesus gave us clear instruction and example in the Scripture. Sacraments involve our physical senses through an outward and visible signs. In addition, they involve our spiritual senses and inward spiritual work of grace. In most Christian churches, we have two sacraments. That's communion and baptism. The Roman Catholics have seven. There are some that have three because they count the foot washing. And then there are some that have zero. Like the French church, they look at it, communion is communing with God each and every day and being baptized by being baptized of the Holy Spirit. Often we think of the supper as a performance, a time when we are on the stage and God is the audience, a ceremony in which we do the work and he does the watching. That's not how it was intended. If it was, Jesus would have taken a seat at the table and relaxed. That's not what he did. He instead fulfilled his role as a rabbi by guiding his disciples through the Passover meal. He fulfilled his role as a servant by washing their feet. And he fulfilled the role as a Savior by granting them forgiveness of their sins. He was in charge. He was on center stage. He was a person behind the moment, and he still is. It is the Lord's table that we sit at. It is the Lord's table that you eat. Just as Jesus prayed for his disciples, he begs God for us. When you are called to the table, many times a pastor will talk about the letter, or it could be elders of a church. But it is Jesus who wrote it. It is a holy invitation, a sacred sacrament, bidding you to leave the chores of life and enter into his splendor. Jesus meets you at the table. And when the bread is broken, Jesus breaks it. When the juice is poured, Jesus pours it. And when your burdens are lifted, it is because the king in the apron has drawn you near. Think about that when you go to the table, because this is an open table for all. One last thought. What happens on earth is just a warm-up for what will happen in heaven. So the next time the messenger, the pastor, or the elder calls you to the table, drop what you're doing and go. Be blessed. Be fed. And most important, be sure you're still eating at the table when he calls you home. Let us pray. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we just thank you and praise you for that invitation. Dear Lord, you have moved from the Passover meal to the Holy Communion. It isn't about the blood putting over the doors, but the blood, your blood shed for the forgiveness of sins for many. So minister to each and every heart. Just as Hadlin said, she knows the bread represents Jesus' body, and the juice represents his blood shed for our forgiveness. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. At this time, would the communion stewards please come forward as they prepare the table for us. If you're not able to come forward, we'll be able to take it to you. But I do want you to hear that this is an open table. This is the Lord's table. All are welcome. All are welcome. You are invited. And on that night Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, he blessed it, and broke it. He says, this is my body. Take, eat, and do this in remembrance of me. And then Scripture tells us after the meal, he took the third cup, the cup of redemption, and he blessed it. He said, this is new covenant. My blood shed for the forgiveness of sins for many. Take, drink, and do this in remembrance of me. Let us pray. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we ask that you bless these elements. Dear Lord, that we'd be drawn closer to your love, to your grace, and forgiveness. Dear Lord, that you minister to each and every heart. And dear Lord, you want all to come. All are invited. And we thank you and praise you for this. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. And when you come forward, would you please place your hand like a shape of a cross? I will place a piece of bread in it. If you need gluten-free, let me know. And then you'll break off after you receive the bread, and then they'll give you a cup, and you will drink that, and there's canisters that you can throw the plastic cups away. And we can also have intinction if you desire. So I'll have you hold the cup too. Would you please come? Thank you.
comfortable standing, would you please stand as we sing our final hymn, the summons that's found in the Faith We Sing, 2130, or up on the screen, 2130. Amen and amen. God bless you all.